Have you ever been finding noise in your measurements and can't tell where it's coming from? There are three main contributors to this. Learn about how to decrease the impact they have on your signals. Hi, I'm Erin. Noise can be a pain to deal with, but it's important to try to minimize it in order to make the most accurate measurements. The main contributors to noise in measurements are your device under test, your probe, or your oscilloscope. In this episode of Probing Pitfalls, we're going to learn about how noise impacts can affect your measurements, what the noise sources are in your probe and your scope, and some best practices that will help you decrease the noise coming from your components. The first thing we'll look at are the consequences of system noise. The system I'm referring to is the probe and the oscilloscope being used together. The sources of noise in the system can come from the probe's amplifier and the oscilloscope's attenuator. Let's start out by looking at the noise floor of an oscilloscope with no probe attached. We can see pretty steady noise on the screen. Now, if I attach a probe to the scope, you can see the noise increases significantly. It's worth noting that this phenomenon will happen with all probes. This happens because you're basically connecting an unterminated antenna if we aren't probing on anything. So it's picking up noise from around the room. This noise level will be reduced when your probe is well grounded, but it's worth noting this increased noise level just by adding the probe. Follow the advice covered in this video to decrease the noise in your measurements. Not to jump too far ahead, but most of what I'm going to talk about revolves around the analog to digital converter, or ADC. ADCs only accept a fixed voltage range. So your signal typically has to be adjusted to fit within the ADC's range. The first is the probe attenuation ratio. Probe attenuation is like a rough tuning. You can use it to get your signal in the right ballpark range. Then the oscilloscope's front end acts as fine tuning. It attenuates and amplifies the signal to get it precisely within the right levels. To learn more about that, check out the oscilloscope front end design speaker series on this channel. So basically, the signal is attenuated to make it smaller so that it can fit within the range of the oscilloscope's ADC. The attenuation ratio of the probe dictates how large or how small of a signal you can measure accurately with that probe. For example, a 1-to-1 attenuation ratio will leave your signal as is. A 10-to-1 probe will scale your signal to be 10 times smaller before it enters the oscilloscope. And a 100-to-1 will scale your signal to be 100 times smaller. If you don't select the correct attenuation ratio for your measurements, you can introduce noise to your system that will throw off all your tests. Higher attenuation ratios lead to more noise because the oscilloscope's front end amplifier noise gets multiplied. As an example, think about a 1-volt signal with a 10-to-1 probe. The signal gets attenuated to be 10 times smaller, or 100 millivolts, and then it's passed to the ADC. However, the noise on that signal doesn't actually get completely attenuated. Therefore, after the signal goes through the attenuator and the amplifier, the signal-to-noise ratio may be even higher than it was before. When that signal and noise goes through the ADC and is displayed on screen, it displays the signal back to its original size at 1 volt. So this means that after the signal went through the ADC, it was multiplied by 10 in order for it to appear the right size on screen. When that signal is multiplied by 10, the noise riding on it is also multiplied by 10. So you can see how using a higher attenuation ratio will end up adding more noise to your system. This can be easily fixed by knowing how to select the correct attenuation ratio for your application. Let's look at this 1-to-1, 10-to-1 switchable attenuation ratio probe as an example. I have two of these probes connected to my scope, and I'm measuring the same signal with both at 200 millivolts peak to peak. On channel 1, I have the probe set to 1-to-1, and on channel 2, I have it set to 10-to-1. If you're working with higher voltages, you'll need to use a higher attenuation ratio, such as 10-to-1. This means that when you connect your probe to the device, the representation you see on the oscilloscope screen will be 10 times smaller than the signal actually coming out of your device. If you're working with higher voltages, shrinking it down 10 times allows it to fit within the range of the ADC and be properly processed. If you're working with small voltages, you'll want to use something like a 1-to-1 probe. Of course, this may differ in some cases depending on loading and bandwidth, but this makes it so you are inputting the properly sized signal into your ADC, giving you a more accurate view of your small signal. If you use a probe with too high of an attenuation ratio, this will introduce noise into your system, and this is actually because of how the attenuated signal is processed through the ADC. For this signal I'm working with on the scope, The 1-to-1 attenuation ratio is the perfect size for it. The 10-to-1 attenuation ratio is excessively high for this. So if I do a peak-to-peak measurement on both, you can see on the 1-to-1 signal, it's about 200 millivolts peak-to-peak, whereas with the 10-to-1 probe, it's about 260 millivolts peak-to-peak. You can even visually see more noise on this signal with the 10-to-1 probe. In addition to that, you must also make your signal as large as possible on screen in order to fully utilize the ADC and reduce noise. This will reduce the amount of gain needed by the oscilloscope. You can see when my signal is scaled to be small on the screen, the peak-to-peak measurement is about 300 millivolts peak-to-peak. When I make it as large as I can on the screen, the peak-to-peak measurement is actually around 200 millivolts peak-to-peak. Attenuation ratio can vary from 1-to-1 all the way up to 1,000-to-1 for really high voltages. There are pros and cons to the various attenuation ratios, but again, it's all dependent on the size of your signals. Using a higher attenuation ratio will bring out more noise from the scope's amplifier, but using a lower attenuation ratio means less noise, but lower useful voltage range. So most oscilloscopes can detect your probe's attenuation ratio, and it will automatically adjust the vertical scale accordingly. You can follow these guidelines and limitations of various common attenuation ratios to help determine what you need for your measurements. One easy way to estimate the amount of probe noise is to check the attenuation ratio and the probe noise level from your probe's datasheet or manual. Many probe manufacturers characterize the probe's noise as equivalent input noise, or EIN, and it will be listed in volts RMS. With this knowledge, you can much more easily select a probe with the correct attenuation ratio for your application you're working on. It all just depends on how big of a signal you're working with, which you'll typically have a general idea of. To wrap up all that information you just learned, your system noise can be exaggerated by your probe and oscilloscope noise levels. Selecting the correct probe attenuation ratio for your application will lower the amount of system noise added. As a result, your measured signal will be a cleaner representation of what's actually on your DUT. To learn more about probing more effectively, be sure to check out the link in the description and subscribe to our YouTube channel to see more videos like this, and follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter.